Painting a model is usually the part that I look forward to the most, and often find the building part is a little monotonous. However, this kit had many unusual steps and unique challenges, which made the building process a lot of fun. The three-color camouflage was going to be a challenge, as I'd never done it before. I decided to use a black and white base, which is effective in bringing out highlights and shadows of a model when layers of paint are applied over it. I wanted to try and preserve this tonal modulation which the base afforded, but this was going to be difficult after several layers of paint had been applied. With these challenges in mind, I started by adding the black base to the hull of the tank and on the wheels, being careful to get into every possible recess and hidden area. This was crucial for creating a contrast with the white base color later. Each wheel was carefully coated and left to dry for at least 20 minutes. Finally, the turret received its coat of black base paint. Once the whole vehicle and its sub-assemblies had received their primary coats, it was time to do the highlights with a second white base coat. I tried to use the white paint to create highlights on the center of various panels. Unfortunately, I went a bit overboard as I sprayed a little too much white and lost a lot of the dark contrasts I was hoping to preserve. Instead of filling only about 50% of each panel in white, I was doing about 75%. The final effect still looked fairly good, but there was a lot more white on the base coat than there should have been. Oh well, it's all part of the learning curve, and I would do better with the next model. Now at least I had a fairly good starting point, and could lay down the camouflage layers to bring the kit to life. To finish off the white basing, the wheel rims also received their coat of white. I tried to be especially careful not to get any paint in the deep recesses and concentrated mostly on the center of the wheel hubs. The instructions suggested that the camouflage colors should be buff, olive drab and flat earth. I was a little concerned with the olive drab, as Tamir's version of the color was a little too brown for my liking, and I felt it needed more green than brown. I opted for the olive green instead, which would probably appear a little too bright in the beginning, but would tone down nicely after a few washes. I started applying the first camouflage layer by using the lightest color, the Tamiya XF57 Buff. The turret was first. I was careful not to spray heavy layers, but kept them light, especially in the shadow areas created by the black base coat. This part of the process was very quick, as the light coat went on without much effort. After the turret, I gave the main gun a quick coat of buff and then moved on to the hull. Here again, I tried to direct the paint towards the lighter parts of the base coat and gingerly gave the darker areas a quick light coat of color. The first coat didn't look too bad, at least the highlights and shadows were fairly well preserved. This served as a good starting point, and allowed the next two colors of the camouflage to be applied in separate layers. Even though it was a light coat, I left it to dry thoroughly for 2 whole hours. At first glance, the camouflage looks a little daunting. I'd like to add here that the pictures are good guidelines, but they can't be followed exactly. One only realizes it once one starts with the masking process, that the top view and left view don't really match perfectly. For example, the beige portion of the camouflage on the front part of the turret should correspond with the following area on the side view. The middle part should correspond with this part on the top view, and the rear part should have at least a bit of beige, but it actually has a lot of brown, which is not in the top view. And the same is true for the rest of the camouflage on the diagram. The best thing to do is to wing it, and try and match up the camouflage where possible, and to modify and preserve the idea of the camouflage where a match is not possible. When I started masking the turret, I traced the outer edge of each beige part of the diagram with a little sticky tack. I covered larger areas with plastic and filled in the smaller areas with a little more sticky tack. I went around the turret, matching the top view with the side views as best I could. I kept a toothpick handy whenever some sticky tack didn't look right or needed minor adjustments. I masked off the beige portions of the gun too, until I was satisfied that the whole turret was done. When doing the lower assembly, I regularly fitted the turret to make sure that the parts of the camouflage which overlapped each other would match up. For the rest, I merely followed the diagram as much as possible. To do the camouflage for the area that was underneath the turret, I extrapolated what was available on the diagram, and the rest was pure guesswork. I examined the areas I'd masked carefully and compared them to the diagram judiciously to make sure that nothing was overlooked and that things matched up as best they could. The next color I applied was the Tamiya XF58 olive green. According to many experts in the field, the trick with three-color camouflage is to go from light to dark, which makes a lot of sense. It's harder to overpaint a dark shade with a lighter one. Unfortunately, the green layer needed to be a lot thicker than I had intended. In order to get the distinct separation between buff and green, I had to make sure I covered every square inch of the model with a decent coat of paint. The green, because of its darkness, was very dominating. In an effort to rekindle my tonal modulation, which the relatively heavy coat of green had decimated, I mixed up a small batch of paint. 7 drops of XF58 olive green to 3 drops of XF2 flat white, and diluted it with 14 drops of thinners. I used this solution to dust over the central parts of the panels and hoped that this would restore the modulation. As previously, I let the paint dry for a full 2 hours before applying the last of the masks. I referred to the painting guide and used sticky tack to mark off all the areas of the turret which needed to be green, which would of course expose the areas which needed to be painted brown. I did not remove the previous masks yet, as these were still needed to protect the beige areas of the first layer. The gun had several green areas, one being quite a large area, which I covered with some paper. The masking of the lower part went quite quickly, mainly because it doesn't have many tricky parts, such as ladders and railings, which one needs to be careful of when masking the turret. Once done, I inspected all the areas of the Rhino to make sure no masks were omitted, as everything that was not masked was going to be painted brown. Once the last of the masks was applied, the Rhino looked quite outlandish. All of the sticky tack masks were checked and compared to the guide, and modified as required. Finally, it was time for the third color of the camouflage scheme to be applied. The last color, Tamiya XF52 Flat Earth, not only made up the rest of the Rhino's camouflage pattern, but it was also the main color of the wheel caps, the chassis, and the underbelly of the vehicle. The brown paint was carefully applied to all unmasked areas, making sure to get enough paint at the sticky tack boundary in order to create a crisp line in the camouflage pattern. After the exposed areas in the camouflage pattern were painted, the chassis and underbelly were painted too, not forgetting to do the wheel caps and the struts. Once again, I made a dilute mixture of 7 drops flat earth to 3 drops flat white and carefully misted the area towards the center of the panels to achieve a bit of that tonal modulation. Removing the sticky tack masks was probably the most daunting part of the painting process. One obviously needs to be extremely cautious as there are a lot of small, fragile parts attached to the vehicle. Sticky tack is quite messy and small bits will stick to the model. These need to be mopped up before the gloss layer is applied, so extra care needs to be exercised in this step. The masks need to be moved slowly and steadily, and only a small amount at a time, in order to preserve both the fragile parts of the build and prevent any peeling of previous layers of paint. I was very happy to see that the divisions between the 3 colors was very distinct, but not quite a solid line. It afforded a realistic appearance to the paint scheme. There were, of course, some areas which would need to be touched up with a paintbrush, but on the whole, I'd say it turned out pretty good. After painting, I finally got around to gluing the wheels on and adding the rubber tires. I was pleased to see that the front wheels could still move in unison, even after all the paint layers had been applied. With the painting finished and the wheels on, the model really looked like it was taking shape. I needed to give the vehicle a gloss coat and do some weathering, so I decided to cover the wheels in plastic to prevent any accidental overspray from damaging the tires. I sprayed a couple of layers of gloss clear coat on the vehicle in order to seal in the paint job and let these dry overnight. The next day the Rhino looked bright and shiny and ready for decals. The kit has very few decals. In the rear, there was a decal for its number plate and 2 tiny non-smoking signs. There was also a larger number plate for the front of the vehicle. I applied all of the decals with some microset to soften them. There were some other details, such as adding 2 of those amazing little fire extinguishers to the back of the vehicle and 2 long metal rods on one of the sides, which needed to be hand painted in a red and white pattern. A second gloss coat was applied to seal everything in and prepare for the weathering. The first step I like to do in weathering is to give the vehicle a dirt wash. Because we've been using acrylic so far, it's best to do an oil wash as it won't damage the paint layers below. I mixed the dirt wash using some black oil paint and a dash of burnt sienna, and added a good bit of odorless turpentine to thin things out. I painted small areas of the model and then wiped the wash off using a clean cloth. The wash has a twofold effect as it tones down the brightness of the paints below and also adds light dirt streaks that would make the vehicle look a little more realistic, like it's been exposed to the elements of the real world. My next step in weathering is to add oil, water and rust streaks to the vehicle. For this I used the Alclad Hogwash range, which has a great assortment of colors and textures to help one achieve a realistic effect. I simply paint these onto the vehicle and remove any excess with a cotton bud. It is a time-consuming process, but if you're looking for a realistic finished product, is well worth it in the end. Of course, one needs to repeat the entire process with the turret too. Notice how the bright olive green has toned down to a nicer, darker, duller, more military green. The last step I do in weathering is a panel wash. It brings out the panel lines, but also the dark recesses in a model. On a darker vehicle such as this one, I use a black panel line fluid. But on much lighter models, such as white aircraft, I would do a more subtle grey panel line wash. I always let the last of the washes dry for at least 4 hours, preferably overnight, before applying the final matte clear coat. If the washes are not left to dry properly, they could react with the matte clear coat and leave a mist-like opaque layer over the model, essentially ruining it in its final step. The last coat is vital, as it seals everything in and gets rid of the shininess imparted on the model by the gloss coat. The toned down version of the vehicle looks a lot more authentic than the shiny version. The small window masks were painted on using a liquid mask, and these are quite easily removed by gently scraping the mask and paint off the windows using a scalpel. The larger window masks are a little more tricky, as they've essentially been sealed in after several layers of paint and clear coat were applied over them. Once again using a scalpel, one needs to gently pry loose one corner of the mask, being extremely careful not to press too hard and leave a mark on the clear plastic. As a final touch, I added soot stains to the engine and the business end of the gun, using Tamiya's Weathering Master Kit B. This added that final layer of realism, and made the Rhino look like it was actually driven somewhere, and that it fired that massive howitzer off at something. So that's the Takom G6 Rhino, all built up, painted and weathered. I hope you enjoyed the video as much as I enjoyed building this remarkable kit. So long, and thanks for watching.
Rhino, everybody knows, you got one tail, 4 feet, 12 toes. Mr. Rhino, look what grows, two big horns on the tip of your nose. 5, 6, 7 makes a herd, and on your back rides the white-tipped bird. 8, 9, 10, you weigh a ton, but you're fast as a zebra when you're on the run. Mr. Rhino, everybody knows, you got one tail, 4 feet, 12 toes. Mr. Rhino, but look what grows, two big horns on the tip of your nose.